We're going to talk about toxins in baby food. As I was saying earlier, it's something that's been all over the news lately. There was a big 42-page report, which I'll post in the comments for you, about the various baby foods that were tested, and they found that 95% contained lead, 73% contained arsenic, 75% contained cadmium, and 32% contained mercury. So that's pretty scary stuff.
Yeah.
We're here to just help you break all down all the information and figure out really what's the best way to raise a healthy, happy eater. So speaking of, I'd like to introduce you to my co-author, Dr. Nimali Fernando. We call her Dr. Yum, and she is the pediatrician and founder of Yum Pediatrics, as well as the Dr. Yum Project. She's going to be telling you a little bit more about that. So, Namali, go ahead and tell everybody about who you are and what you love to do.
Well, first of all, thank you for having me on tonight. This is a really very timely topic, I think. I think, I know we've gotten a lot of questions about this topic with everything in the news, so I'm happy to be able to talk about it and give people a little bit of perspective on the study that was recently published. So as you said, I'm a pediatrician. I happen to love kids and food. And I have blended these two passions into a unique career where I spend a lot of my time teaching my patients and my community how to eat great food so that they can have a long and healthy life. And started an organization called the Dr. Yum Project, which helps families in my community really understand this connection between food and health. And we do that by educating families about nutrition and showing them how easy it is to make wonderful, delicious, budget-friendly, easy food, and how to raise their kids to eat that type of food as well. And so Melanie and I have teamed up on various projects. We share a lot of the same passion, so it's fun to talk about. I know your favorite topics are kids and food too, so it's perfect conversation.
Well, definitely. And you and I were actually chatting 2 days ago when we heard about this basically a new statement. It's a 42-page statement, and it was made by Healthy Babies Bright Futures. And they are an alliance of scientists, nonprofit organizations, and donors. And they're here to try to reduce exposure to neurotoxic chemicals in our children. So they were following up from research that was done several years ago, where we noticed that or learned that in especially brown rice, surprisingly, but in rice products in general, they tended to absorb more arsenic than anything else. And it's something that you and I have chatted about when we've done other webinars and other courses for parents and professionals. But this particular statement came forth, and it really sounds, frankly, a little scarier. But when we took a look at this, as I said, 42-page document, and we really kind of broke it down, what I was surprised to see was it isn't really so much baby food. Yeah, that's what they tested. It's just food in general.
That's right.
Yeah. So when parents said to me, well, what if I just made my own baby food? That isn't, I mean, that's awesome and for a lot of different reasons, but that isn't necessarily an ideal solution, although it does have some benefits. But I know that you're a big proponent of making your own baby food, but you're also fine with the occasional jarred food for convenience, et cetera.
Definitely, definitely. Yeah, I mean these metals are ubiquitous. They're in our soil, they're in our air, they're in our water. So, eating foods that are homemade are wonderful, and I'll talk a lot about that if your viewers are interested. But making your own baby food doesn't really buy you a ticket out of those exposures necessarily, nor does eating organic. These things are everywhere, and so it's really a matter of dose and perspective on how to, minimize the risk.
And just for anyone listening, yes, organic has its advantages in terms of the lack of pesticides, et cetera, that we've always been familiar with. But in this situation, it has as much to do with just what's already in our soils, in our water supply, and the way these particular foods tend to absorb these toxins. One of the main reasons that rice absorbs these toxins so well is because it's grown in water.
That's right. And as you mentioned, brown rice, although it seems like a healthy choice for many reasons, whole foods in general, we tend to want to gravitate towards. But in this case, the outside of the brown rice is where a lot of these compounds will concentrate. And so those tend to be removed in white rice products.
Right.
Which is pretty interesting.
It is, it's kind of counterintuitive, really, because brown rice, for many reasons, as you said, is so much healthier. The other thing that the article said was that any sort of rice snacks, like, oh, the little cans of puffs, you know, that we all buy for babies. And you're the one who taught me that really you recommend to your families that they only buy one canister of those. And that's it. And I know, as a speech language pathologist who specializes in pediatric feeding, I say the same thing to my families too, because those are a learning food. And so those are also almost all rice flour.
Right.
Think about rice now being condensed down to a flour. You can see why those are going to have some of the highest concentrations of these toxins.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, really when I talk to parents about their concerns about products like rice, cereal, the other products that were mentioned in the study were juice, right? And then root vegetables, which tend to concentrate those metals, so carrots and sweet potatoes.
Right.
You know, these are great baby foods, you know, so we don't necessarily want to eliminate them from our diet. But we also want to make sure that there is enough variety, right? So especially when you're teaching your new baby to eat food, I always say you want the volume to be low, but the variety to be high. So low volume, high variety.
Yep.
And, you know, in the beginning, the reason I say volume low is because we are taking our baby from being a milk drinker to a food eater. And in the beginning, when they're going through this very very steep period of growth, we need them to get the fat, the protein, and the calories. And that is primarily coming from either breast milk or formula. So when they're in that period of growth, we don't necessarily want them to take a large volume of solid foods,
right?
Because they may not have quite the density of calories, fat, and protein.
Sure.
So the volume should be low, right? So we're giving our babies these little practice opportunities throughout the day, but after milk feedings. So their belly is plenty full of milk, and then they're practicing those little bites and not eating, you know, two jars of baby food at 6 months. Those volumes really need to be quite low.
And the thing is that when we're thinking about low volume, high variety, right?
Right.
Incorporate that into some of the strategies like the carrots and sweet potatoes by making our own baby foods and mixing in other, not only other foods like, oh gosh, you know, maybe some protein or a tiny bit of fruit or whatever it happens to be, but also not only by mixing those in, but also by remembering we're not going to serve a whole lot of that.
Right.
Not only keeping the volume low in terms of just the carrots, just the sweet potatoes, but by mixing in other foods. You're really keeping the volume low.
Right.
Yet, you're getting a lot of variety and a lot of flavor.
And a ton of flavor. So that variety, volume low is the first part of that. Variety high is the second part. So that means variety in a lot of ways. So variety of different nutrients that they're getting when you offer different foods.
Right.
And then you're minimizing the variety of undesirable contaminants like pesticides and heavy metals, things like that. And then you can vary the cooking method. So as you mentioned, with brown rice, cooking in a lot of water and then straining that water off can minimize the arsenic exposure. But the variety of cooking techniques also increases the variety of flavors, right? So if you roast a sweet potato, it may be a little bit different than if you prepared it another way, if you steam it, for instance. So the variety of cooking methods also should be, you know, interesting and different. Sorry, there's a cat behind me. He's just going to be there. You know, just having that variety so that babies are constantly, they're in this very receptive period in the beginning. So they will eat just about anything that you provide for them. And so it's important that you take the opportunity to offer that variety of flavors, of nutrients, of textures. That's everything for you, right? Texture. Yep,
absolutely.
And flavor can also mean, you know, adding things like spices. You know, spices can be really important. This cat wants to snuggle.
About food. He's like, right.
Where's my dinner? So having that variety of texture and flavor too. So I think a lot of people have this idea that babies really should have single ingredient, very bland, smooth, easy to eat foods. And some of that is true. We always talk about those first exposures should probably be very safe, smooth, easy to swallow. So their first experiences are comfortable, but very quickly we can start to introduce a lot of, you know, a little bit of challenge, right? In terms of flavor, adding spice. I tell my families, you know, you can add things like curry powder. You may not want to add a lot of very spicy, intense flavors in the beginning, but things like cinnamon and turmeric and just a pinch can really challenge your baby's palate and imprint some of these lovely flavors, not to mention that there are a lot of great health benefits to those spices and flavors as well.
Those herbs have a lot of antioxidants, and the spices themselves have some anti-inflammatory properties. They're really, really good for us.
That's right. That's right. And, you know, we also want to add variety when we think about, you know, high allergen foods too. So I just attended a conference with a great talk on food allergies, which really stressed a lot of the recent research that we really should be varying up lots of exposures, including those high allergen foods, especially if you don't have a family history of food allergies. You can pretty safely start introducing a variety of high allergen foods. So the top eight food allergens being dairy, soy, wheat, tree nut, pea nut, fish, egg, shellfish.
Sure.
And those can really, you know, help in the end, ultimately, to prevent food allergies. And so that variety can be really important too. It's really interesting, when I had my children years ago, we were taught to do one food for many days, right?
3 days.
3 days. And if there was no problem, then we move on to the next food. And really the research shows that that doesn't prevent food allergies. What that does, if you think about this recent study too, is you're doing carrots for 3 days and nothing else, right?
Right.
Or you're doing rice cereal for 3 or 4 days. But that variety, as we said, can minimize those undesirable contaminants too. So what we found is that varying the exposure from the beginning, it actually doesn't necessarily perpetuate food allergies, and doing those 3 days doesn't prevent food allergies. So, you know, my current advice is to try a variety of foods, and, you know, maybe it's sweet potatoes in the morning, maybe it's green peas at lunchtime, maybe you try a little sweet potato in the afternoon, or you mix some of those ingredients. And of course, if there's a family history of food allergy or a concern about food allergy, then you talk to your pediatrician and sort that out. But that variety can actually be very protective for food allergies, which is really interesting.
It's so interesting. And you know what, as you mentioned earlier, one of the things that they talked about in this 42-page statement that I keep telling you about, I mean, it was long. It was
long
to decipher.
I salute you for reading it.
Well, I think I was telling you I read it because I got a phone call 2 days ago from NPR, and they're like, "Are you smart on this tomorrow?" And I'm like, "Can you tell me what you're gonna ask me?" I'm like, "No, we're going to talk with you, man." I was studying that thing up and down, saying what they were gonna ask me, and it turned out to be a real blessing because what I realized was, as scary as this is, and yes, we need to make changes to make sure that all food is healthy for everyone.
Right.
The reality is that it's what we're all eating. And if we can take some really active steps to make sure that the babies don't get that much of it, low volume, high variety,
right,
I think we're going to be okay. So as I said, when I was speaking to them, hey, listen, I don't want anybody to freak out because there's some rice on your kid's plate, you know?
Right.
But on the other hand, do be aware that rice flour, rice snacks really should be limited. They're, as a therapist, they're a learning food, but go for those whole foods, not processed snacks, whenever you can.
Right.
And the same thing with juice. You and I have talked about juice many, many, many times. And the thing is there's one thing about juice that is awesome. It tastes good.
Yeah. Because it's sweet and delicious.
It's sweet. Now, sometimes you talk about maybe treating it as a medicine. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. So actually, the American Academy of Pediatrics most recent statement is that juice should really not be introduced before the age of 12 months, and that it should be limited after 12 months. I think it's 4 ounces up to three, 4 ounces a day up to 3 years.
Right.
And then a little bit more after that. You know, I occasionally will use it for constipation in infants. And it's a very good, gentle laxative. I have my three favorites, which are pear, prune, and apple juice. Uh-huh. And sometimes we'll use that as a first line for constipation, full strength in a small cup. And so it's effective for that. But beyond that, it is a processed food. There's a lot of sugar. And you know, it's a concentrated amount of calories that we would never eat as a whole food.
Yes, absolutely. And for me, I don't want kids sipping on juice. A, it's really bad for their teeth.
For their teeth, that's right. Right.
But B, it's so quickly absorbed that it just stops their appetite. Just stops it in its track. And I need appetite to help kids learn to try new foods.
That's right. So,
on the other hand, if we just think of it as a treat, in Adventures in Veggie Land, which is right over my shoulder here, along with, oh, look at that, Raising Healthy. Somebody I know helped me write that. Who was? Oh, you.
Oh, Lord.
But our book, Raising Healthy Up Eater, and we talk a little bit about juice. And in Veggie Land, I have a few recipes that include cooking the vegetables in the juice, but then you pour off the rest of the juice.
Right. So it imparts the flavor.
More flavor. And that's what we keep getting back to.
That's right. That's right. So, you know, I tell parents, and you know, if you're going to let your kids eat, drink juice, that's fine. At a birthday party, as a special treat, that's great. If you're out to a special dinner and they want to have a little cup of juice, that's fine. But make it an outside of the home drink. If it's inside of the home, then you have to parent around the limits of juice.
Right.
So remove that parenting challenge and just don't bring it into the home. And then you don't have to parent around it. And really, water and milk can be two good choices for home, and leave the juice for special occasions.
That is such good advice and such a simple way to handle it. I love that. You're so smart.
Well, thanks. I learned a lot from you. I did. So one of the things that back to variety that we talk about a lot at the Dr. Young Project is this idea of one meal, one family.
Right.
So we want kids to have the same kind of variety that we would eat. So we would get bored of eating carrots for 3 days or even just carrots for one meal. And so we really try to teach families that we teach in our teaching kitchen or that I see in my practice, that the meal that you're eating probably will make great baby food. If you've had a home cooked meal that you've prepared for your family, why not turn that into baby food? And so on our website, we have a whole section called baby food options.
Yeah.
And if you click on the baby food options, you will be surprised that there are, you know, recipes like chickpea curry, or lentils and spinach with brown rice. We actually teach a baby food class occasionally in our kitchen, and we serve those foods to our youngest eaters, and they love them because they're very flavorful. And babies usually under 12 months are kind of flavor seekers, so they love those foods. And so really, if parents just think about, how do I make this delicious meal that I'm eating safe and soft for my baby to swallow and enjoy, then there's that natural variety that we enjoy that our baby also gets to enjoy as well.
I think that's such a good way to round out this conversation. I know when we were raising a healthy, happy eater together, it was really important that we included examples of how parents feed their children in other countries, not just here in the United States where you and I hang out.